kind invitation to spend this hour with you. It's always a pleasure for me to be with you. I've been with you before, and in fact, I was here many, many years ago for the dedication of this building, and I was a young minister in Spokane. Years have passed since then. My remarks today are taken from my latest book, Transcendentalism and the Cultivation of the Soul. The Transcendentalists have been, I'd say, a preoccupation of mine for many years. They come out of our Unitarian tradition. They were religious radicals and social activists who were involved in many reforms, not the least of which were reforms to Unitarian worship and church life. The two hymns that we're singing today are both hymns of Transcendentalist ministers. One, the first one being Emerson. He had been a Unitarian minister. Theodore Parker, prominent Unitarian minister and Transcendentalist, was the first one to introduce flowers into worship service to the dismay of his more conservative colleagues. That we have volunteer choirs is a result of reforms that James Freeman Clark made to his congregation. And he also turned the governance of his congregation over to a board of volunteer members. He was the first to do that. So they are with us in spirit, if not as present in our minds as they might be. They had a real interest in other religions and religious traditions, and they read them for insight and inspiration, and they compiled anthologies of readings from poetry and from these other religious traditions, and we still have that in our hymnal today in the back where we have all of those readings. That was another gift of the Transcendentalists to the Unitarian movement. And many developments, changes in Unitarian worship and religious life are due to their influence. We're going to have a reading, responsive reading, if you'll join me. Let's see. Number 575. Another one of the prominent Transcendentalists was Margaret Fuller, remarkable woman. Her book, Woman in the 19th Century, was the first feminist manifesto written in this country. And this reading is adapted from that book, and perhaps you'll join me in reading it responsibly. A new manifestation is at hand. A new hour is come.
When man and woman begin to regard one another as brother and sister, able both to appreciate and to prophesy to one another.
A new manifestation is at hand. A new hour is come.
What woman needs is not as a woman to act or rule, but as a nature to grow, as an intelligence to discern, as a soul to live freely and unmediated, to unfold such powers as are given to her.
A new manifestation is at hand. A new hour is come.
Man does not have his fair share either. His energies are repressed and distorted by the interposition of artificial obstacles.
A new manifestation is at hand. A new hour is come.
When we would have every arbitrary barrier from our family,
were this done, we believe a divine energy would pervade nature to a degree unknown in the history of former ages.
A new manifestation is at hand.